Welcome to V8 Nation, talking all things motorsport with Rick Kelly and Paul Dumbrell.
Hello everybody and welcome to V8 Nation. Rick Kelly and Paul Dumbrell to join me in about 5 seconds. My name's Cameron Luke and we love V8 Nation. We love your emails as well, v8nation@crocmedia.com. Or you hit us up on Twitter, we'll get stuck into the emails and the tweets shortly. Fair to say that V8 supercars have got a lot of airplay over the last week or two, and it's good to see the promotion of the sport, not good to see exactly what happened. But, boys, good to see, actually, that you've actually got back to the V8 Nation studio safe and sound. Good evening to you, PD.
Absolutely. What a week it's been in motorsport. Yeah, it's great to see that, Cam, you to see the promotion of the sport. You like the car burnt to the ground.
I don't. May have come out wrong, but it's good to see VA getting a little bit of promotion.
No, it is. You know, it got screenplay on every single news I saw flying back from Perth, and it's had, you know,
all
had
around
a million,
the world.
Yeah, had a million hits because it is. You don't see too many start line crashes these days,
particularly fiery ones.
Yeah, we've had two big notable ones that I know of my time, and the last one was 7 or 8 years ago, and that was Paul Morris at Oran Park.
So long time.
And we'll talk about the car of the future tomorrow, but with the fuel tank in the back of the car, our fuel tanks now are 80 litres. Start line, they're pumped full, they're boiling hot, they're expanded because they've got no air in them, I think. Oh, that's what the engineers tell me anyway. And you know, that impact, you know, I think how fast did he hit the guy in front of him? Or how hard did Owen hit to Reiner?
Well, very quick. That's my answer because I really don't know how fast he was
between
going,
140, 150 was being reported.
Yeah, but it shot the car of Carl's right up in the air. So it was obviously a massive impact. And you could see from a few photos from that, there was a lot of the car was already on fire, but you could see so much fuel vapor past the car and all over it that hadn't actually ignited at that point. So was a very big accident. I generally thought that there's supposed to be flag marshals every two grids away waving flags when there's a car stalled. And I'm not sure, I didn't see any of those. And generally the radio, your engineer or the crew is always on the radio ready to go to tell you which way to go if there's an accident. Mm. So I think obviously, you know, it's rung a lot of alarm bells, but that needs to be looked at a little bit further.
And looking at that, they had a TV camera in the actual starters box, and that marshal actually saw that the car stalled, and he put a sign up. It was literally maybe 50 or 60 centimetres by 30 centimetres.
Yeah. Piece of A4 paper.
Saying car stalled. Yeah. Mm. And, hey, you probably saw it. Rico, you were somewhere near the front. You know, I was down the back just making sure everyone, you know, just
got
kept
through
it,
okay.
Yeah, you know, just kept it cool and, you know, just shake and bake. And I had no idea. I came up and I think I started 20th or 21st or somewhere down there. And he started 8th, I think it was, or 6th.
14th.
Carl? Okay, 14th. There you go. So I wasn't that far behind him. And,
well, Rico, you were next to him, weren't you?
Yeah, I started next to him and I kept an eye on him trying to obviously get a jump off the line, and I noticed he'd stalled. And I actually got around three corners and then saw the red flag come straight out. And as soon as that happens, you know that there's something massive going on, because normally they start with the yellow and then they work out what to do. And then once I got around the corner and looked at coming back up over the hill, all I saw was like a mushroom cloud from that area, and you're like, oh no, this is bad.
Well, funnily enough, I came out of turn one and they were talking, our crew came on the radio and said there was a yellow flag out, and I looked right. I was still racing, but I looked right and there were, I actually saw the, like, you know, still flames and stuff burning, and I just went, geez, that's just unbelievable. And and it's scary to see. We all know motorsport's really, really dangerous and whatnot, but it takes an incident like that to actually realise how dangerous it is, and something so small like stalling on a grid. And how big the impact an accident can be. And, you know, Paul Carl, you know, he's reasonably well and whatnot, but, you know, I guess, you know, his injuries, you know, he's got secondary burns on his hands, and just the intensity of the fire, you think about being doused you know, 60 or 70 litres worth of fuel inside the car. The flames on the outside, Steve Owen said he couldn't get out of the car because there was flames burning on the outside of the car. Carl Reiner's car was on fire inside the car, so he couldn't get out quick enough. And I spoke to him afterwards, and he said that, you know, the window net was melting, the Perspex windows melted, like, and we're talking like in a 5 or 10 second period.
Yeah, and also at that point, he'd just been impacted from behind massively as well. So it's not like you're ready to get out and you're thinking about it. He'd be pretty sore from that shunt as well. That was definitely a massive impact. And I think the FIA states a certain amount of time that it must take you to get out of the car is an absolute
Yep, definitely.
maximum. So I'm not sure what that would be, but these days you've got a cool suit, your radio plugs, your 5 or 7, however many point harness we wear these days, and the window net, which is on the door, and then not a proper door handle, generally just a cable inside. So when you add all that up, it's a lot to undo before you can get out. And generally, when you panic, you forget to do something like that, like the cool suit, and it doesn't just pop out. It normally rips you back towards the car. So it does take quite a while, and it's definitely worth practicing that.
And even after my accident in New Zealand, you go away, and I looked at my harnesses because, you know, I sort of had some damage to the family jewels. And and you go away and look at what you can do better. As soon as I saw that incident for the next race, I actually got them to look at the hoses and how we disconnect them off the cool box. Because sometimes when you forget to undo your radio, undo your cool box, you get out of the car and you nearly get jammed back in the car.
Yeah, they should be aimed.
They should be aimed. Make sure that if we need to jump out of the car that they quickly disconnect rather than actually having to go down there with your hand. And even looking at the marshals, talking about the marshals, We all talk about, you know, a lot, how we go motor racing is a lot of the stewards and the officials, they're all voluntary. So everyone, you know, comes along, you know, gets a free cut lunch and they do the flag marshals for the day. The drama is with our sport now and how dangerous it is. It took, I don't know, Rico, how long it was, but it wasn't within a minute or 45 seconds. It took a marshal or a fire truck to actually get to the car. A team member of another team jumped the fence with a fire extinguisher.
Our team.
Was it your team?
Yeah. No, you do it all.
Kelly Racing. I'm surprised you didn't jump out, mate, and do it yourself.
Well, the only thing is, I'm bringing it up because I'm going to need to get reimbursed for that fire extinguisher.
Well, I don't know if we can get that those expenses approved on V8 Nation, but we'll give it a crack. But, a team member from another team jumped over the fence and he was the first person on the scene. So
that's a worry, isn't it?
It is, because if Carl was knocked out, which I'm surprised he wasn't knocked out because an incident like that, you know, I've hit the wall a number of times in my career, certainly a lot less than that, a lot less in speed. And you're a bit groggy, you're maybe not 100% there. 150 kilometre an hour crash, someone in the back of you, and you're not knocked out. Like, if he was knocked out, unfortunately, I don't think Carl would be here with us. I think, you know, the extent of his burns and whatnot would just be, you know, too much.
Well, I think a normal safety type car and a fire truck follow the back of the grid. So the car that actually hit them, Steve Owen, I'm pretty sure he was off the last one or two rows of the grid, which means there should have been a fire car right behind him. So it should have been pulling up to that accident as he almost had the crash. So it is definitely, you know, an interesting one. And I think there's been a lot of investigation post that accident as to why it did take so long.
Just before we get stuck into some more stuff, you were behind him as well, Peter, and you would have been reaching a fair amount of speed by the time you went past the crash. One, how fast were you going? And two, did you have to deviate at all from your line of your driving?
Yeah, definitely. We were probably only maybe going, you know, 110 or 120 as we got past him, as a bit of a guess. But the further and further you get down the back of the grid, the faster and faster you actually get to that point. So, you know, if you're starting one spot behind him and you see him stall, you're only maybe going past him at 20 or 40 kilometres an hour. When Steve Owen started, he literally did start 26. He was doing 140 kilometres an hour, and Dave Reynolds was the car just in front of him. And he sort of obstructed Steve Owen's view. And at the last minute, and I talk about the last minute, Dave saw, obviously, Carl's car stalled. He turned hard right and actually spun onto the infield. So that was how close he was. I reckon he was less than a foot away from hitting the back of the car, maybe even closer.
Yeah.
And Steve Owen, you saw the rear vision. His foot touched the brakes as he made impact. I don't think he actually would have slowed down 1 kilometre an hour before he hit the car. So that's just a tough thing. And we talk about safety and making sure our teams and engineers tell us about these things. It just proves, you know, how critical this sport is a team effort to actually, you know, make sure we get through, you know, the first lap and off the start line.
And Petey, how was your weekend?
Hey, mate, about as good as yours, mate.
Well, I just want to say, Rico emailed me Monday Ava, I think it was, and said we need to talk about the sand and PD because he spent a lot of time deep in there.
I didn't have my best weekend, and we didn't qualify very well. And as Rico well knows, and I've spent a lot of my career in the midfield towards the back, when you qualify down there, they are literally, and I'm being polite, Muppets.
They are
incredible. Seriously.
Oh, no.
Some of these guys, we're racing for the Formula One World Championship for 23rd position.
Yeah.
It was just ludicrous. Like, some of the stuff that was going on, and when you're down the back, you always end up being in the wrong position at the wrong time and someone hitting you off and you get frustrated. And off the start line in the first race, Michael Caruso actually fought for Carl's cart, turned hard left just on the start line and hit me. And I went onto the grass on the left-hand side of the start-finish line. And, like, you know, my left-hand mirror folded in on the fence.
Really?
So I'm like, what Valvoline car, you know, hit me on the start line on the boys to the radio? Because I was literally going to allegedly Paul Morris did. I was going to drive around and find him and knock him off. And that was the start of my weekend. And I took a mental note that, hey, I probably should just take a deep breath, find Rico and do it to Rico.
Yeah.
last time I did it to him, I got a free watch, so I know it works well.
Well, we found it your weekend, PD, and have you got anything to add? Calling anybody a Muppet or anything, Rico, or are you a little bit more reserved in how your weekend went?
No, look, I just
oxygen
had
oxygen thief, maybe.
We better talk about that, actually.
What, me stealing oxygen?
No, someone stealing your suit, I believe.
Yeah, look, that was the one of the worst parts of my weekend. I left the suit in one of our race trucks when the door was open.
Mm. Don't look on eBay.
Short amount of time. And someone's wandered off with it, which is a little bit of an issue. We only get a couple of suits a year, and they're worth just under $4,000. So a bit of a bummer, but those things happen. But yeah, on the results side, pretty average weekend. I saw some of that funny business going on. It's what PD is speaking about, and I saw a lovely young gentleman by the name of James Moffat absolutely drill PD in the door and send him straight to the sand trap. And there's actually, you should watch the replay of that race. He's blocked about six or eight people and driven like a complete, what was your?
Muppet,
which is, you know, happens from time to time. I don't know if that's getting him back out of jail, but that nothing got done about you getting in the sand trap.
It was an ironic situation. I actually got passed by Dave or Murph or one of the Kelly cars, and so they passed me, and he came from two cars back, sailing down the inside, hit me at the apex. He was dead by my side, and I went to the sand trap, and there was eight laps to go, and they didn't call a safety car, so our race was over. And the stewards investigated it, and they said there was no case to answer because he was up to my B-pillar at the time he hit me. And I said to there's a bit of a gentleman's agreement on the track that if the car that's passing the car on the outside is up to the B-pillar, which is in between the rear door and the driver's door, you know, that's an acceptable level. But where that system's flawed is when the car behind's doing 40 kilometres an hour quicker than you.
And can't stop and uses you as brakes.
Yeah, exactly right. So... Hey, every dog has their day, I think the saying is. And,
I can't wait to see what's going to happen.
I can't wait for winter because PD's going to stew over this for the next couple of weeks and it could get very, very interesting.
This is V8 Nation with Rick Kelly and Paul Dumbrell.